This music is not my own. I do not own the rights to this music. We just use it to edify the body of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus Christ. Glory to Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Wait for a few folks to get on here. Love you guys. Amen. Praise the Lord. We're going to go right into the Bible.
You know, when you've been called to do
right into the book of Hebrews. Hallelujah.
Sometimes.
Welcome to our live Bible study and welcome to our podcast. I thank you guys for joining in. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your spirit. We thank you for your blood that was shed for us on the cross. Father, help us to be more humble. Help us to live sacrificial lives. Help us to yield to your spirit. Help us to deny our flesh, deny ourselves, and take up our cross daily and follow you. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your patience. We thank you for your peace. Father, I pray for everyone that's listening, watching, Lord. I pray for their families. I pray for their marriages. I pray for their children, God. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, you said, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by no means harm us. Father, in Jesus Christ's name, we bind up every evil spirit that will come to destroy their houses, that will come to destroy their children, that will come to devour them, God. We stand in the gap right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, help us to walk in newness of life. Help us to have the mind of Jesus Christ, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, Father, we worship you. We love you. We adore you, God. Thank you for ordering our steps, God. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Refresh us in your spirit, God. Refresh our hearts. Refresh our minds. Give us a heart that has depth for the word of God. Father, help us to forget those things which are behind and to press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Thank you for ordering our steps, God. Thank you for your word that's a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, open up our minds, God, and our hearts to receive your word. Transform us, God. Help us to walk in humility. Help us to walk in maturity, that we would let our light so shine and men may see our good works and not glorify us, but glorify you, God. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for your spirit. Thank you for my brothers and sisters that has joined me tonight, God, and feasting on your word, God. Give us a heart that has depth for your word, God. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, help us to walk in a right spirit. Renew a right spirit within us and create a clean heart in us, God. Give us a hunger and a thirst after righteousness. You said those that hunger and thirst after righteousness, they will be filled. Father, help us to put away all foolishness, all childishness, God, and cause us to walk in maturity as we obey your word, God, as we walk in the spirit. You said we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Father, give us a hunger and a thirst after your word, God. In Jesus Christ's name, that we may apply it line upon line, precept upon precept, precept here, there, here little, there little, In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, Father, we thank you so much for your blood. We thank you so much for your spirit. We thank you for your grace. Help us to walk in grace and to extend the same grace and mercy that you've given us and you've extended to us in the person of Jesus Christ. Help us to extend it to others. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. I want to welcome you guys in. Thanks for joining. Once again here, every Thursday we are here. Every Thursday with a live verse-by-verse Bible study. We've been in the book of Hebrews. We started in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1, and we've come to Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10. We will cover verses 10 through 14 tonight. And we also said, remember we said that the Bible is Christological, meaning that it directly points to Jesus Christ, or indirectly, every text, every jot, every tittle, every book, everything points to Jesus Christ. And the Bible is a Christological book, meaning it is Christ-centered. So the messages that the man of God or the woman of God bring across should be Christ-centered messages. And so we try to stay with Jesus Christ as the theme of our messages, and we choose the verse by verse format to develop contextually intelligent Christians that can rightly divide the word of truth, and that Christians that can handle the word of God. The Bible says in Hebrews, skillful. You know, we want to be skillful with the word of God. And the Bible says that all scripture is given by inspiration of God. That's the Greek word theonupsis. All scripture is theonupsis, meaning it is God breathed. It is inspired by God. It is the infallible, inerrant word of the living God. And if you're not reading from the Bible, you do not have the word of the living God. There's all kinds of books out here that claim to be holy, but there's only one book that can transform your life, and that is the written word of the living God. And it's spoken by the living word, Jesus Christ. We dealt with that a few weeks ago on the five ways in which the word of God comes. And it comes in many different ways. And Hebrews chapter 1 says, God hath in these last days spoken unto us by his son, Jesus Christ. He has not spoken to us through Buddha. Hebrews says that. Hebrews chapter 1. Right here it says, God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spoken times past unto the fathers by the prophets, the Old Testament, Hebrews chapter 1, 2, verse 1, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. God speaks to us through the Son of God. He doesn't speak no other way. There's no other revelation. There's no new revelation. I don't care what Joseph Smith and the Mormons tell you. God has not spoken to us through Joseph Smith. God has not spoken to us through Buddha. God has not spoken to us through Eastern mysticism. God has not spoken to us through Islam. God has not spoken to us through Jehovah's Witness. God has not spoken to us through any other occult. God has spoken to us through Jesus Christ. And if the person is not teaching or pointing you to Jesus Christ, then that is not of God. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. Hallelujah. Let me get into my lesson. I feel like preaching on that. Jesus, Philip says, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us. Jesus says to him, have I not been with you all this time, Philip? And yet you say, show us the Father? He says, he that hath seen me hath seen the Father. Believest thou not that I am in him and he is in me? If you don't believe that, believe for the very work's sake. You know what I'm saying? He said, believe me for the very work's sake, because the works that Jesus Christ did pointed to his position in the Godhead. And that's what Jesus Christ is. He is 100% man and he is 100% God. The Bible says God was manifested in flesh. 1 Timothy 3:16, God was manifested in flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentile, believed on in the world, and received up into glory. Jesus Christ is God Almighty. And not only is he God, he is 100% man. And listen, Paul said there's one mediator between God and man, and that's the man, Christ Jesus. Yes, the man, Christ Jesus, is seated right now as a man in a glorified body, as the second person in the Godhead, or the triune Godhead, Paul calls it. That's a more biblical term, the term Trinity. I know what it means, and I believe in the Trinity, but that's not a biblical term. The more biblical term is the triune Godhead. Jesus Christ is the Word of God. He is the living God in a body. Remember that God said that my word will not return unto me void, but it will accomplish what I send it out to do, and it will prosper in the thing whereto I send it. And God's word did not return to him void. He sent it out, right, in the form of the Holy Spirit, and it took on flesh in the womb of the Virgin Mary. And that same word, it was born, it walked amongst men, it did miracles, it slept, it cried, it healed the sick, it raised the dead, it calmed the seas, it suffered, it hung on the cross, it went down into the grave for 3 days and three nights as Jonah was in the fish's belly, or the belly of the whale. So shall the Son of Man be in the heart of the earth 3 days. And he ascended on high, right? He came up, he came down. What is it that he that first descended also ascended, Paul says. And so God's word did not return to him void. It did not return empty. It returned back with a body. Amen. That's what he says. He says, lo, I come in the volume of the book, as it is written of me, to do thy will, O God. He says, sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings for sin thou wouldest not, right? Hebrews. He said, but a body hast thou prepared for me. He says, lo, I come in the volume of the book is written of me to do your will, O God. Jesus Christ came forth from the Father and in the form of a spirit, and he took on flesh inside of the womb of Mary. Like Mary said to Gabriel, how shall this happen? Gabriel says, you will bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus. Mary says, how shall these things be, seeing I know not a man? He says, the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore, that holy thing which shall be born of you shall be called the Son of God. And so we get to this point here in Hebrews chapter 2. In Hebrews chapter 1, Paul is saying that Jesus Christ is greater than the prophets. He's greater than Moses. He's greater than Joshua. He's greater than the angels. He's greater than all Old Testament saints, and the Melchizedekian priesthood, is more superior than Aaron's priesthood or the Levitical priesthood. You guys will hear me say this often, that at the baptism of John the Baptist, when Jesus Christ came to be baptized, John the Baptist says, no, I will not baptize you. He says, I have need to be baptized of you, and you're coming to me. And so John the Baptist, who is the last of the Levitical priests, remember John the Baptist, he is a Levite. Remember his dad, Zacharias, is of the tribe of Levi, Luke chapter 1, and his mother, Elizabeth, is of the tribe of Levi, Luke chapter 1. And so John the Baptist, because he is a priest, he is the only one who was qualified. Remember the Old Testament priests, they had to inspect the animal to see that if it was without spot or without blemish. And they had to inspect it and give it to the priest to make sure it's fit for sacrifices. And so John, in John chapter 1, 29, can say this, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. And so he's the only one that can inspect Jesus Christ. Remember, he said, I knew him not except he that sent me to baptize said, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descend and remain, he it is which baptizes with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And so at the baptism of John the Baptist, what you see is, you see the end of the Levitical priesthood, right? The Levitical priesthood is going down. It's over with. The Old Testament is over with. And that's why Jesus Christ says, thus becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. And also, he is in our stead as a human. He's baptized. He didn't need to be baptized for sin. That's why we're baptized. And that's what John's baptism was about, is a water baptism, baptism of repentance, baptism of repentance from sin. So Jesus Christ needed not to be baptized or repented because he never sinned. So at Jesus Christ's baptism, he is identifying with us as a human. He's identifying with us. And also, it is the end of the Levitical priesthood, and it is the inauguration of the Melchizedekian priesthood. And so we see one priesthood going out, the old is going out, and the new is coming in. And that's what the new wine was about when he changed the water into wine, when he filled up the Old Testament sacrificial pots. Remember, there were six water pots, right? Six, the number of a man. Man, that was man's shortcoming. And God is stepping in like he always does and filling in where man falls short. They fell short at the wedding. And so there were six water pots after the manner of purification of the Jews. And Jesus Christ says, those water pots, fill those up with water, fill them up to the brim, right? That whole sacrificial system is over with. It's complete. And now draw out now. Excuse me. He says, draw out now. And there's new wine there representing the new covenant, which was coming in. So now let me get to the lesson here. Hebrews chapter 2 is so much. Hebrews chapter 2, verses 10. And we'll cover these verses and I'll get out your way. It is talking about the humanity of Jesus Christ. He is a human being. How is he human and yet God? Because he took on flesh in the form of a spirit. He took on flesh. And so he gave up his omnipresence. And that's the only thing he gave up. He couldn't be at all places one time and one time at all places. Excuse me. He gave up his omnipresence. But as a man, he slept in the boat. And as God, he walked on waters. As a man, he suffered and cried. But as God, he raised the dead. As a man, he was beat and stripped and wounded for our transgressions and our sins. But as God, he rose himself from the dead. And so there's a Greek word called the kenosis. So while in the kenosis, he prayed, he slept, he wept, he felt sorrow. Remember, he's a man. Isaiah said he's a man of many sorrows. And acquainted with grief, and so that this is the Jesus that we serve. We serve the Jesus that we serve, not a high priest, right? Who cannot be who can be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, and he can relate to us. He was tempted in all points as we are, yet without sin. So we don't serve a high priest that cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, and so he is a man. And that's what this book, Hebrews, is going to talk about, especially in 1 and 2. So in chapter 1, we see the exaltation of Jesus Christ, sorry. And in chapter 2, we see the humiliation of Jesus Christ. And so when Jesus Christ came down from heaven, he brought God to man, right? He's our representative. He represents God on earth to man. John chapter 1 verse 8. No man had seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. The Greek word declared there is the Greek word exegenomai, meaning that he reveals who God is. And so it is the only way you can find out or have an encounter with God is to have an encounter with Jesus Christ. And when you have a true encounter with Jesus Christ, you are having an encounter with God. But you cannot. He says, no man has seen God at any time. It is the only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father. He had declared him. So he hath revealed him. And so he brings God to man. he reveals God to man, and now in heaven, he represents us to God. Okay, so while he was on earth, he revealed God to man, and now in heaven, he represents man to God. We have a man in heaven right now that represents me. He's our advocate, right? If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And if we sin, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse up of all unrighteousness. So we have an advocate with the Father. Let me get into this text because it's just so much. All right, so Hebrews chapter 2, verses 10. That's where we stopped at, verse 10. He says, for it became him. For who are all things, and by who are all things, and bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. And when it talks about it became him, he's talking about the Father. Him refers to the Father. Him is the Greek word prepo. It's becoming, or it is proper. It is fitting for God. So Paul wants us to understand, and he wants to reaffirm that what happened to Jesus was according to the plan of God. Hebrews chapter 2, verses 10. For it became him, for whom are all, talking about the Father, for it became him, the Father, for whom are all things, and or for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory. So this whole thing to heaven, Jesus Christ had to suffer. This was all in the plan of God. Remember, the Lamb of God was slain where? When was God, was Jesus slain? The Bible says the Lamb of God was slain before the foundation of the world. So where was he slain? He was slain already in the mind of God. He was slain before the foundation of the world. He was slain already in the mind of God. So for it became him, Paul is saying, verse 10. And that's the Greek word prepo, meaning it's becoming, or it was fitting for God to do this and bringing many sons to glory and to make the author of their salvation perfect through sufferings. Now, let me deal with that real quick. My God, it's been 20 minutes already. Wow. So he says to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. A lot of people, especially people, you know, that misinterpret the text, they say, look, Jesus wasn't perfect. He was made perfect. I've had some JW say that to me, false teachers say, see, look, Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10, he was made perfect. No. This is not a moral perfection or a sinless perfection. He was already that. He was already perfect. He was without sin. John already announced it. Even before he went to the cross, John said, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. That tells you right there that he's spotless and without blemish. He's perfect. That tells you right there. So what does it mean when it says, in bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering? All right, the perfect through suffering is a positional perfection, meaning this: in order to Jesus, for Jesus Christ to get to glory, to get to where he is now, remember that the suffering of Jesus Christ, it began. He says, and now am I glorified. Remember, every time he talked about his death, he talked about being glorified. So the glorification and the suffering are the same thing. And so in order to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering, positional perfection, in order to for the job to be complete, suffering had to take place first. Suffering had to take place first before Jesus Christ can ascend on high. Suffering had to take place first before Jesus Christ could get the glorified body. Suffering had to take place first before he can bring many sons to glory. So he made the captain of our salvation perfect through suffering. That's a positional perfection. And it's the same thing with us right now. If we're going to get to where God wants to take us, we will have to be made perfect, or to be made mature, or to be made complete, or to finish the work. That's what this is talking about. To finish what God has called us to do, there's going to have to be some suffering that takes place. there's going to have to be some suffering that takes place. And none of us wants that. I don't want that. None of us wants that. But as he is in the world, the Bible says, so are we. And we take the same footsteps as Jesus took. And this is where a lot of false teaching come in. They try to escape that route. There's no escaping that route. There's no escaping that route. If we want to be like him, as he is in the world, so are we. And so we can teach all kinds of doctrine to try to escape or to evade suffering, but it's a part of the walk. It's a part of life. But guess what? These present tribulation that we go through are not worthy to be compared with the future glory that shall be revealed in us. So, and bringing many sons to glory, Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10, he had to go through suffering. That's what it says, that to make the captain of this salvation perfect through suffering. Amen. No pain, no gain. Amen. And that's what it's about. But we have to take the same footsteps as Jesus take. He says, if you don't take up your cross and follow me, you're not worthy of me. You know what I mean? Any man that loves father or mother, husband or wife more than me is not worthy of me. And so a lot of this stuff that we go through and a lot of decisions that we make to follow Jesus Christ will involve some suffering. Remember that John saw those who were beheaded during the great tribulation. And he says, what are these under the throne of God? And the angel says, these are they that were beheaded for the testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's some suffering that has to take place, even in our study life, even in our prayer life, even in separating ourselves from family members. That hurts sometimes. Even in separating ourselves from our friends whom we love, that hurts sometimes. But it's beneficial, because just as it made the captain of our salvation perfect through suffering, God wants to mature us and make us perfect through suffering. Not perfect, morally perfect. None of us are perfect, but perfect as far as maturity and as far as his will is for our lives and as far as walking with him goes. We are made perfect through suffering. And so Jesus Christ was made perfect through suffering. Not that he wasn't perfect morally, because he was perfect. He was without spot or blemish, but positional perfection. In order to get where he's seated at right now, he had to go through some suffering. So verse 10 says, for it became him for whom are all things. It's talking about the Father. And by whom are all things, and bringing many sons to glory. That's just what this whole thing is about, bringing us to salvation and bringing many sons to glory. That's sons and daughters. Let's be clear on that. It's bringing many sons and daughters to glory. He had to suffer. And it was part of God's plan. It was part of God's plan of salvation that his son would suffer. He poured out his wrath on him. That's why he said, Father. His humanity was crying out. He is a man. Jesus Christ is a man. And he's a man right now, still a man in the glorified body, but he's still a man. The Bible says there is one mediator between God and man, and that's the man, right? Christ Jesus. And so he says, Father, if it be possible. Now, if the Son of God, our Savior, the one who created the heavens and the earth, if he felt pain and pressure and even seeking a way out, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. But then his spirit man, being the God that he is and having all the power and the universe that he has, he says, nevertheless. And that's what God wants us to get in our spirit when it comes to studying, when it comes to reading, when it comes to praying, when it comes to walking in victory, when it comes to living a sacrificial life. And that's what this whole life is about. It's about a sacrificial life, the same life that Jesus Christ lived. He says he was rich. He had all, everything, but for our sakes, yet he became poor. And bringing many sons, he submitted himself to the limitations of the flesh. He submitted himself to the Father's will. It got so bad that night in the Garden of Gethsemane, the place of the olive press or the wine press. It got so bad that the Bible says he began to sweat, as it were, great drops of blood. He experienced is called hemedidrosis, meaning that blood began to spill over into his sweat glands and to begin to come out of his pores. He experienced hemedidrosis because he felt the pressure and the weight of sin on him, and he saw it. He tasted. He says, "Let this cup pass from me." What cup? The cup of God's wrath. That's why he told the disciples, "Are you able to drink from the cup that I'm going to drink of, or are you able to be baptized with the baptism that I'm about to partake of?" And so he said, "Father, if it be possible, as a man and his humanity, let this cup pass." He said, "Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done." And so Jesus Christ, because he was in the flesh, he is able. We're going to get to that verse. The last verse he says, "Because he himself hath suffered being tempted, he is able also to help those that are tempted." And that's why we look to Jesus Christ. We don't look to man. You know, we can sometimes count each other out. We can sometimes give up on each other. We can sometimes be distant from each other. We can sometimes say that, oh, you're going through that because God is punishing you, or you're going through that because of something you've done, or you're going through that. And it's just a part of the human experience that we have to be there for one another, to pray for one another, especially the Bible says, "You which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering yourself, lest thou also be tempted." So we have a human high priest, Jesus Christ. The Bible says that he is a man, right? And so he's able to relate to people that are depressed. Depression is a real thing. And Jesus Christ said, the Bible says that he is a man of many sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we despised him, and we did not esteem him, smitten of God. You know, Isaiah said he had no form nor comeliness that we should desire him. He was just like a common person. He was so common that Judas had to betray him with a kiss because he looked like everyone else that he hung out with. That's another topic in itself, when you got people that don't even want to look like or can't relate to the people that they're ministering to. But that's a whole nother topic. But he was so common. Jesus Christ was so common that the Bible says that he was a man of many sorrows and acquainted with grief. And so if you've gone through depression, if you're going through struggles, if you're going through fears, if you're going through doubt, if you're just trying to make it, Jesus Christ is the one to go to because he has been there. In fact, he said the foxes of the field have holes, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. And so this is why we cling to Jesus, because that's one of my favorite verses. He says, Hebrews chapter 2, verses 18, I believe. He says, "For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to help those who are tempted." Amen. Let me move on. Verse 11. He says here, "For both," this is key, right? "For both he," and I'm going to stop with this, "for both he that sanctifieth and those who are sanctified are all of one, for which cause he is not ashamed to call us his brethren." And that Greek word for sanctified is the Greek word hagiazo. That is the Greek word for holy. So it is saying here that a saint is someone who has been sanctified or made holy by Jesus Christ. For both he that sanctified and they who are sanctified, set apart, are all of one, meaning we have the same flesh and blood. Jesus Christ is a human just like we are human. Look at that. "For both he that sanctifieth," Jesus Christ, he makes us holy. That's the word, Greek word hagiazo. He makes us holy. We're not holy. None of us are holy in ourselves. In fact, our righteousness is as filthy rags. That's why none of us can't brag about where we are right now. None of us. Because we were sanctified. For both he sanctified us. He made us holy. "For he hath made him to be sin," right? 1 Corinthians 5:21. "For he hath made him to be sin who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." Our righteousness is as filthy rags, Titus 3:5, for not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. We were all filthy, we were all nasty, messed up, we were all in darkness. We once had our conversation in the world, Paul says, and we once walked according to the course of this world. Don't forget where God has brought you from. He made you holy. You didn't make your own holy. I remember when Peter and John was in Acts chapter 3, when they healed the man that was begging at the beautiful gate, and all of the people began to look at Peter and John, and they said, they was looking at them, staring at them, after they had healed the man by the power of Jesus Christ. And Peter and John says, "Why look ye so earnestly upon us, as if it were our own holiness or righteousness that made this man to walk?" They said, it's not our own holiness or righteousness that caused this man to walk, but by the name of Jesus Christ, this man is healed. And so it is no goodness in our own flesh. In fact, in this flesh dwelleth no good thing. And so we are not to point people to us to say, look at me, look how holy I am, look how powerful I am, look, I'm obedient, I'm an obedient servant of God, you better be like me. No, you don't have no own holiness of your own. The Bible says, for both he that sanctifieth and they that are sanctified are all of one, for which cause he is not ashamed to call us his brethren. We have the same flesh. He has the same flesh and blood that we had. He went through the same thing that we went through, yet without sin. And so now, and that he has suffered being tempted, he is able also to help us who are tempted. Our righteousness, our holiness, everything that we have is found in Jesus Christ. Outside of him, I am a wretch undone. Who shall deliver me from this body of death? He says, Paul says, I thank God for Jesus Christ, my Lord. For if any man be in Christ, in him, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all become new. Christ in us is the hope of glory. Christ in you is the hope of glory. So when we stand before God, my only hope to get into heaven is because of Jesus Christ. Christ, and greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. It is Jesus Christ, because he is our advocate. He stands in the gap for us. His blood speaks for us. We have a blood that speaks better than that of lambs and bullocks and goats and turtle doves. We have a blood, the blood speaks better things than that of Abel. Jesus Christ's blood is on our behalf. That's the only reason why we can stand before God. That's the only reason why we have a right to the tree of life. He is seated right now at the right hand of God. When he went down into the lower parts of Hades and he preached to those that were in prison, to the spirits that were in prison, the Bible says that he went up and he presented the blood of the covenant on the mercy seat. In the Old Testament, they had something called the Ark of the Covenant. And the Ark of the Covenant, they had over top of the Ark of the Covenant, they had the mercy seat. And overlooking the mercy seat, oh my God, overlooking the mercy seat, they had two angels. They called them cherubims. And the angels' faces looked down at the mercy seat. Listen at this now. The angels, the cherubims, they represent judgment. Remember when Adam sinned, the Bible says that God placed a cherubim at the entering of the garden, or to keep the tree of life, lest the man should eat of the tree of life and live forever. So cherubims, they represent judgment. And so now you got these cherubims that standing over and looking down into the Ark of the Covenant. And guess what's in the Ark of the Covenant? You have the Ten Commandments are in the Ark of the Covenant. You have Aaron's rod that's in the Ark of the Covenant. And you have the jar of manna that's in the Ark of the Covenant. The jar of manna represents man's complaining. Man is always complaining about what, that's what they did in the wilderness. They complained, and God gave them the manna, and they said, we don't want this. What is this? They said, we would rather be off in Egypt, where there were garlics and leeks and good stuff. And so that represents man complaining. Man still complaining against God this day. And so inside of the Ark of the Covenant, you had the jar of hidden manna that represents man's complaining. And then you have Aaron's rods that budded. That was when they rebelled against Aaron and Moses, when they said, throw down your rod, each of them. And they threw down their rods. And God said, whoever rod buds, this is the person that I've chosen. And Aaron's rod budded. Aaron's rod
God calls Aaron's rod to bud. And so inside of the Ark of the Covenant, you had that rod that budded that represents man rebellion. And then you have the Ten Commandments that represents man's sin, how man is so ugly compared to God, how we all fall short of the glory of God. We all fall short. And so inside of the Ark of the Covenant, you have the Ten Commandments. You have Aaron's rod that budded, and you have the jar of manna. And so all of that represents man's shortcoming. And God's judgment is looking down on man in the form of the cherubims. But in between the eyes of the cherubim and God's judgment on man, you have something called the mercy seat. And the mercy seat is where the blood was applied once a year when they went in on the Day of Atonement. The Jews call it Yom Kippur. And so Jesus Christ went up on the Day of Atonement when he went and presented the blood on the mat, on the mercy seat. He presented the blood. And that's why we can come boldly to the throne of grace, because the blood has been applied to the mercy seat, and it is by Jesus Christ. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. I thank God that Jesus Christ died for my sins, because I am a wretch undone. Paul says, I am the chief of sinners. All of the wickedness that I have done, all of the filthiness that I have done. Listen, the Bible says that Satan is the accuser of the brethren, and I don't know about you. The Bible says that he accuses us day and night before the throne of God. And I don't know about you, but Satan has a lot of ugly things and a lot of mischievous things that he can accuse God for me on. But guess what? My advocate stands up and he says, there's nothing that can accuse my child, because his sins have been paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. And we have a man that represents us. I better stop. We have a man in heaven that represents us, Jesus Christ. And his blood, it became him, the Father, Hebrews 2. It became him by whom all things and for whom all things, and bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. For both he that sanctifieth, verse 11, he that sanctifieth and they that are sanctified are all of one. For which cause he is not ashamed to call us his brethren. We are his brothers. And so if Jesus Christ is not ashamed to call us his brothers, who are a little lower than the angels, I'll keep it clean. All of our rebellion, all of our stubbornness, all of our sin, Jesus Christ, when we came to him and were born again and we turned from the world, he covered us. For which cause he's our brother. For which cause he is not ashamed to call us his brother. I'm not ashamed to call nobody my brother that's in the faith, even with all of our struggles, even with all of our shortcomings, even with all of our inconsistencies. We all have things that we need to conquer. We all have things that we need to get better at. He says, Paul says, I am confident that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ, until the day of Jesus Christ. So now listen, if God has to perform something in you, right, until the day of Jesus Christ, that means that you are not complete and you are not perfect. And that means that you still have things that God has to get out of you. He has to perform it until I am confident that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. That's why the Bible tells us to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. Yes, there are some things that we have to do. We have to yield to the Holy Spirit. We have to yield our members as members of righteousness unto life. Just as we yielded our members as members of sin unto death when we are in the world, now we yield our members as members of righteousness unto life. Paul says, and I'll finish with this, Philippians 3:12. Not as though I had already attained, neither were already made perfect, but I follow after that, if that I may be apprehended by that also which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Father, in Jesus Christ's name, we thank you so much for Jesus Christ interceding for us. Help us, Lord, to dig deep and be patient with one another. Help us to rely on your spirit. Give us a hunger, Lord, and a thirst after righteousness. Father, we know that there are things that we have to separate ourselves from in order to grow in you. Give us the strength and the courage, God. Father, I pray for everyone that's listening. I pray for their families. I pray for their marriages. I pray for their children. I pray for teenagers, God. I pray, God, that you would protect their hearts and minds from all of this adult information that's bombarding their spirits and minds, God. Father, in Jesus Christ's name, I pray against every foul spirit that will come to hinder your work in the lives of your people. We thank you, Lord, because when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against him. Father, I thank you for your blood that covers us. In Jesus Christ's holy and righteous name, I thank you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Guys, I love you guys. Thanks for joining in. Thank you for your love for this ministry. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for your concerns. I just thank God for you guys. You guys are such an encouragement to me. You're such an inspiration to me. And I do not take this ministry lightly. I do not take it lightly because Paul calls Satan the prince of the power of the air, Ephesians chapter 2, right? He says Satan is the prince of the power of the air. And so where are we now? We are on the airways right now. We are right on his turf and in his territory. And so I do not take this ministry lightly. You can listen to the message. I'll upload it on YouTube and I will put it on the podcast, ronwright628.podbean.com, and also visit our group page, Abiding in Christ Ministries. I'll send you guys, if you're not already a part of the group, we play videos on there. We play live Bible studies, and sometimes I just put a list of teachings on there where you can listen to different teachings for 4 or 5 hours straight. You know, saturate your heart and mind with the Word of God. I love you guys. One more prayer. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and may the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you peace. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Share the video, guys. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God shall a man live. I love you guys. Pray for one another. Pray for me. Let's care for one another. Let's not fight and argue. Paul told the Galatian church, he said, if you bite and devour one another, take heed that you be not consumed one of another. That's spiritual cannibalism. And we see a lot of that, especially on social media. Man, even some of the nicest people say some of the meanest things on social media. And we need to guard our spirits as Christians. We need to make sure our spirit is right, and that we are doing this for the right reasons. I love you guys. Share the video. Let's encourage one another and be patient with one another and care for one another and comfort one another and challenge one another in love. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless.